We're going to get started. And we want to thank you all so much for being here and thank our fantastic panelists for being here. My name is Nuala O'Connor. I'm the CEO and president of the Center for Democracy and Technology. We want to thank our friends at the National Restaurant Association for hosting us today in this beautiful space, especially my friend Dawn Sweeney for agreeing to share this day with us. And this is one of a series of events that CDT is hosting called Always On, and it's our exploration of how we are impacted in our daily lives by the technology changes in industries and sectors all over the world. So today, as you can see, is a really wide-ranging discussion focusing on every aspect of food and hunger and industry. And it's only going to whet your appetite, to use a food metaphor. We're not going to be able to cover all the questions, but really going to pose a lot of them and get you thinking and continue the dialogue after today. As you all know, CDT stands for the individual, the power of the individual online, our privacy, our free expression, our digital selves. But we also believe in the power of technology to do good and make the world a better place. I always use the examples of healthcare and the environment and education, but what greater societal need to solve than for hunger and the ability of people to get food quickly and to the right place at the right time? So the changes in technology are empowering industry to know more about their customers and know where to put their goods and services. It's also empowering the individual to know more about their own preferences and habits and to share information, as we'll hear from Yelp, about personal preferences and habits and choices. Technology, like in every sector, is a disruptor here, and we're going to hear about that today, and we're going to hear about the impact on the individual in this great space. So I'm going to turn it over now to my great friend and colleague, Allie Lang. Allie is one of our policy analysts at CDT, and her work focuses on this area, and in particular, how the digital world affects users and how users can regain control of their digital presence. We work on issues of fairness and transparency and algorithms, protecting our digital assets and decedents' estates issues, and the intersection of civil rights and big data. But I am just excited that Allie is a member of our team and that this is her project and that she has taken it from idea to passion to event to dialogue. So I'll turn it over to Allie. Thank you so much. Thank you for being here.
Thanks, Nuala. And thanks, everybody, for being here. I'm going to introduce our formidable and huge panel in this direction. So next to me is Laurent Crenshaw from Yelp. He's actually the head of federal public policy for Yelp in DC. And Laurent and I had a really good conversation a few months ago about Yelp's efforts to work with nonprofits and with the government to sort of make health inspection data more available to users by using the Yelp app as a conduit, which is really important. So it sort of highlights one of the ways in which, you know, the private technology sector can intersect with food and the public sector. Next to Laurent is Virginia Eubanks, who is a writer, community organizer, and researcher focused on economic inequality, digital privacy, and sort of database discrimination generally. And so she's sort of representing the voice of the researcher thinking about data being collected about and used to make decisions about and for people in general, but specifically people who are maybe underserved in other contexts. Next to her is Pam Hess, who is the executive director of Arcadia, which is a nonprofit organization in DC whose mission is to create a more equitable and sustainable food system. One of the main ways they do this is they have two vehicles that drive around to low food access neighborhoods and offer healthy food from farmers. And we're gonna hear from her a little bit about a point of sale app that she sort of spearheaded to facilitate those interactions. Next to her is Mojde Bahar from the USDA. Mojde is the Assistant Administrator for Technology Transfer at the Agriculture Research Service, arm of the USDA. So has sort of an eye on what the USDA research needs and work look like. And finally, we have Laura Chadwick, who is with the Restaurant Association, who we'd like to thank again for hosting us. Laura is the Director of Commerce and Entrepreneurship here, which includes handling issues related to data security, data privacy, swipe fees, patent reform, music licensing, and taxes. So Laura seems not very busy at all. So to kick us off, I'd like to actually throw the first question to Mojde, and it would be great if you could tell us a little bit about what kind of research the USDA does, and what kind of data you guys have specifically on nutrition and food, and just sort of hear a little bit more about what that process looks like within the department.
So I work for the Agricultural Research Service, which is the research arm of the agency, and we have four pillars of research. One is animal production and protection. Second one is crop production and protection. We also do research in natural resources and sustainable ag, as well as nutrition, food safety, and quality. And I think today's discussion is probably either the intersection of the last two or mostly focused on the last one, the nutrition, food safety, and quality. And the Nutrition, Food Safety, and Quality program at ARS has actually many goals, one of which is giving nutrition data, nutrient data, and looking at nutrient data and use for our nation. It has as one of its goals to prevent obesity and obesity-related diseases, to find out the relationship between agricultural practices and nutrient content in foods. And as one of the projects, we have a nutrient data lab that manages what is called the standard reference database that contains over 8,000 different food items and nutritional information, as well as up to 150 food components. And it includes information such as water content, caffeine content, sugar, alcohol, anything that basically we, vitamins and minerals that are important to the consumer. And it's accessible online and can be searched actually, and you can all take advantage of that.
Thank you so much. One of the early conversations I had when we were
planning this panel was between Pam and I, and we talked a little bit about sort of the data that's collected around how people use the USDA benefit system, including SNAP benefits and WIC and other programs. So part of what Pam's app does, and I'll let her explain, is sort of manage some of the perks of those programs to make it a little bit easier for point of sale at markets to take advantage of them. But also they've collected a little bit of data about how people use those things, use those programs, and we want to sort of hear from Pam and anybody else actually just on the question of sort of what is the potential of this data. And specifically curious about, you know, the fact that sort of private sector entities like Walmart, you know, have a pretty vast database and a pretty good understanding of what SNAP benefits are used for, whereas the USDA and sort of the public sector entities don't really have as much information, and what kind of dynamic that creates.
It creates a very strange dynamic. The big companies are, you know, they have their point of sale systems. Millions of people are going to Walmart and buying food or going to Target, and they use that information to profile their customers so that they understand, so the customers, they know what the customers want or what they're likely to buy, and then they use that to send coupons to them or do promotions online. And this is all proprietary data. These companies spend hundreds of millions of dollars on systems to collect it and analyzing it because it's all about their bottom line. This, because it's proprietary, it is not available very easily to researchers or to the government. Walmart owns their data, Target owns their data. So subsequently, when USDA wants to figure out what people who are receiving federal nutrition benefits like SNAP or WIC or Senior Farmers Market Nutrition Vouchers, they generally have to rely on surveys. So they'll talk with people afterwards and say, what did you buy? People notoriously lie about their healthy food habits. So it's very hard to drill down and know what people are buying. And what we do know, just rest assured, is that people who are using SNAP are buying about the same food that the rest of us who are not using SNAP are buying. We all have terrible diets. The country is 70% overweight. So let's just sort of take that stigma right out of it. But people are quite interested in what people who are low income are eating. We're quite interested in that in Arcadia. So we have these two vehicles that we load up with food that we grow on our own farm, and we buy food from other local farms all within 125 miles. All of the farms use sustainable methods. And we make 19 regular weekly stops in low food access neighborhoods. Heavy use of food stamps, low car ownership, no grocery store, usually within a mile. So people are on foot, they don't have a lot of money, and they don't have a lot of choices for healthy food. So we go to the same time, same place every week, and we set up a farmer's market. We accept and we double SNAP, WIC, and Senior Farmer's Market nutrition vouchers. So low-income people come to us in droves. We represent just 2% of all farmer's market revenue in the city, but about 20% of all SNAP that's collected at farmer's markets in the city. So very high impact that we're having in low-income neighborhoods. Here's our challenge. We have a small staff. We have tons of food moving in and out of the buses, lots and lots of customers lining up, some of them for 90 minutes before we get started in order to access a special DC benefit that I'll tell you guys about if you're interested, and you will be. And so we are at the point of sale for the last 3 years just kind of tearing our hair out. We accept 9 forms of tender: SNAP, WIC, Senior Farmers Market Nutrition Vouchers, PPP, Veggie RX, cash, debit, and credit. That's 8. I'm missing one. And we double some of them. Some of them are only good for vegetables. Some of them are good for veggies and meat and fruit. So it's very complex at the point of sale, and it's frustrating for everybody. So over the winter last year, we developed a point of sale system on an iPad that's just like anything that you would see at any store, where it has icons for beef and eggs and whatever. And it makes things much, much faster for us. And it does this other marvelous thing, which is if somebody is using SNAP, we'll double SNAP for proteins or for fresh fruits and vegetables. That will go right into the register, and we can turn around and say, hey, you still have $7 left on your SNAP, so go back and get some more. And it's fabulous. People get a ton of food. Just so that you know, the data that we have been able to collect for the first 3 years has all been based only on our SNAP terminals. So anything that was coming in with cash or debit or with paper WIC vouchers, we have really no idea what people are buying. And indeed, with the SNAP terminals, you're just running an EBT card. You don't know what people are buying. But we do know that 50% of all of our business comes from people using some kind of federal nutrition benefit. We know that 70% of our SNAP transactions are people who have been to the market before, so we're developing a good habit. We know that from the first year to the third year, the average SNAP transaction went up $8 to $18, so more than doubling. People are really doubling down on healthy food. What we don't know is exactly what they're buying. Last year, DC introduced something called the Produce Plus program, $10 free fruits and veggies for anybody who's income qualified, which is a lot of people in the city, and it has been just going gangbusters. This year, they put $400,000 into it, and these are the people who come and line up for 90 minutes at our farmer's market before we open. They're 90 years old, and they're waiting in line in the middle of summer heat because they want that $10 in free fruits and vegetables. It is inspiring, and it is heartbreaking. But people really want this stuff, and it dwarfs SNAP at the farmers markets. So DC is quite interested to know, how is PPP affecting how people eat and what they buy? And our point of sale system, it turns out, is gathering all of that information, which is really exciting. We know what somebody's buying, not the person, not who they are, but what they're buying with PPP, whether they're reaching into their pocket to grab their EBT card or if they're going for cash. If they're going for cash, what is it, that thing that caused them to go and use their own resources to get food? We know that WIC moms are buying mostly fruit. We know that PPP actually goes for mostly fruit, and we're going to be looking into why that is. Is it because fruit is easy and delicious and sweet and everybody loves it? Or is it because fruit you don't have to cook? And do people not have kitchens that work? Or do they not have culinary skills that work? We know that right now, most people use SNAP to buy proteins with us. So they're buying eggs, milk, and cheese with us. And then they're using PPP for their fruits and veggies. What we don't know is what happens when PPP ends, which it does right now. Will people now start using their SNAP benefits for fruits and vegetables? And if they're not, how do we encourage them to do that? Because obviously there's a lot of health with that. So we are collecting, I'm not a data person, we are collecting this enormous, enormous resource simply just in our little corner of the city at these 19 farmers markets. And we're going to open this up to public health researchers to start to dig into it. And I'm hoping to talk DC into expanding our point of sale system across the city so that we have 27 more points of data and we can really begin to see how people are leveraging their nutrition benefits to benefit their families. Everybody wants to eat healthy food. The real barrier we have understood over the last 4 years is where you live and whether or not you have easy access to a grocery store and whether or not you can afford it. And healthy food is far more expensive for most people than processed, cheap, shelf-stable food. And I just point out that either you pay the farmer or you pay the doctor. And I think we should be paying the farmer. The end.
That's a lot of information. I think one of Pam's major themes, or something that your comments brought to mind for me, is that there is a lot of public benefit to be gained from having more granular data and more information in general about how benefits are used, but also about what people are eating. But I do think there's probably some risks involved as well. That's something Virginia could give us some perspective on, how collecting this kind of data on people and their preferences and habits, what level of granularity should it be collected, what are the risks and what are the benefits from the perspective of just sort of being concerned about making it more of a surveillance program versus something intended to help people.
So I have the depressing position of going after Pam's incredibly inspiring, exciting news of this incredible program that I want to learn more about, to sound the note of caution, which is
I think it's really important that people understand that data that is collected about groups of people really can have vastly different impacts depending on who those people are, and particularly around what sort of social assumptions are about how much control they should have over their lives, about whether or not they're sort of valuable, worthy citizens or not. And when you're talking particularly about people who are accessing public assistance, we live in a culture that stigmatizes the use of public assistance, and we live in a culture that blames poverty on the behaviors of individual people rather than, say, on structural issues around capitalism. And that's a long conversation we can have later. But what I would like to say is that there's a lot of reasons for people, poor and working class people, to be skeptical about information that is collected about them. And there's reasons to think really rigorously about what the impacts of that collection might be. And I'll just give you a couple of examples. I think two easy and then one that you might shout at me about. And that's fine, because I love that. I'm not as optimistic and excitable as Pam, but I do like a good fight. So we can get to that, I hope. So two of the examples come out of the state of Maine. For some reason, Maine is like leading the way on using public benefits data to stigmatize their citizens. One is in the last year, the governor of Maine, Governor LePage, released a body of data that was about where people were using their EBT cards as part of a very focused plan to make it more difficult to use EBT cards in places like strip clubs and liquor stores. So he released on the web publicly to everyone, it's not personally identifiable information, but neighborhood level information about where people were using their EBT cards, particularly where they were getting cash from their EBT cards, right? The assumption being if you're getting cash in a strip club, you're going and buying lap dances or whatever. I think that's an assumption, and that might be the only thing in your neighborhood. So that's another conversation. But this was very much part of a political effort to make it more difficult to use EBT cards in the kinds of businesses that exist in low-income neighborhoods. And that really can constrain the ability people have to meet their needs in their own way. Something more specifically, more recent, is just in the last week, again in Maine, the mayor of Lewiston, Maine, Robert, I keep forgetting his last name, that's why I wrote it down. Robert McDonald, the Mayor McDonald proposed a plan that would create an online public registry of all people in the state of Maine who were receiving welfare benefits. That would include their names, their addresses, and the length of time they've been receiving benefits. I don't think this is actually going to happen, but it was responded to quite positively by a lot of folks. And what I think is interesting about this example is clearly, his plan was all about increasing stigma. So I'm just going to quote him here. This is from the Portland Press Herald. He said that he hoped the registry would help keep people off of welfare. And he said, quote, "Go into a grocery store, they flaunt it. Some people are going to get harmed," he continued. But if it's for the good of everybody, meaning people not on public assistance, that's the way it is. I'm not sorry. I hope this makes people think twice about applying for welfare, right? So clearly his goal is increasing stigma. But one of the things that I want to point out is that the stigma is an important impact of sometime opening this kind of data. But it also would be really easy to imagine writing a little web script that could then go scrape that data out of that public database, and then you create a database of people who you know are struggling to meet their basic needs, which then becomes very useful for people who, say, sell predatory loan products or predatory educational products. So it's about vulnerability, not just to increase social stigma, but also just very direct economic and social vulnerability. Okay, so just so I'm not picking on just Maine, though I'm happy to do that too. I am from the state of New York. I live in Troy, New York. And our lovely Governor Andrew Cuomo, about 2 years ago, decided that they wanted to, this did not pass, but attempted to create a system of what EBT cards would not, or SNAP benefits would not be able to be used for sugary drinks, right? Soda, Gatorade, whatever. And this is the one that I think we might have a little bit more dialogue about, because I think healthy food is good. But what I also think is good is self-determination. And I think that, you know, we were talking coming in about, like, I own a home, I get about $1,500 from the government every year for to, you know, support my lifestyle because I own a home and they support that. And I can go use that to buy Oreos and Sunkist, you know, as long as the day is, or, you know, drugs or lap dances or whatever it is I want to use that for that's legal. And so I believe that self-determination is an important goal for all people, and that because every man, woman, and child is equally and infinitely precious and valuable, that we all have a basic right to self-determination, to making decisions for ourselves. And I'm not convinced that paternalistic programs that constrain people's food choices are particularly effective for helping us all make more healthy decisions. And so that's the one that I'll throw out to maybe discuss a little bit later. But that's where I'll leave it for now.
I actually would really like to hear Mojay's response. So it sounds like there may be benefits to collecting some of this data and using it for public good. There may be potential harms. But as it turns out, there are also just real barriers to collecting the data, practically speaking, from the USDA's perspective, and sort of depending on the research you want to do. So I wanted to hear a little bit from Mojay about sort of what are the barriers for the USDA in actually getting any of this information. And how do you guys think about, you know, expanding collecting it or not?
So I think, as both Pam and Virginia mentioned, there is a lot of pushback from some manufacturers on proprietary information. And while it makes commercial sense for them to have that proprietary information, that's really good information to have for, you know, doing things like nutritional trend studies to see what is being consumed and, you know, what the results of it are long term. So manufacturer pushback is part of one of the barriers that we actually encountered. Some manufacturers are very good, and if, you know, they're in the business of healthy foods, they are very, very willing to share that data with you. But there are manufacturers that, you know, wrongly or rightly are not, you know, known to produce healthy foods, and they probably will push back on sharing their data. That's on the manufacturing side, but there is also a huge data component to this, which is collection of this data usually is, you know, bigger than anything that we as a government agency probably have the infrastructure for. So a lot of the open data initiatives are actually now coupled by increasing the IT infrastructure so that that data can be collected and it doesn't become a burden for whoever is providing the data should the data be provided. So there is a very practical aspect to data collection that I think it's really important as part of the discussion.
Great, and actually a perfect segue to what I want to ask Laurent, which if actually you could sort of more eloquently explain what Yelp has done with your sort of health inspection data, but also I would really love to hear about how it was to sort of work across sector, you know, being a private technology company, partnering with both a nonprofit and working with government to create a public good in a way that I think, unless Virginia disagrees, is generally conscientious.
Sure. So in case people in the room or watching this on the video don't know, Yelp is an internet and mobile platform that basically connects people to the best of either businesses or things that are around them. And sort of a big part of the draw is the fact that it's also a review space. So you can share your experience with a particular business or place. And so kind of a little bit piggybacking off of this, the discussion from earlier about data and sort of acquiring data or mining it or collecting it, we're sort of in a different and unique position because we're a platform where people generally tend to volunteer their data in the form of their experiences with. So that thankfully, we kind of avoid a lot of the issues that we're talking about here in regards to privacy and whatnot for the most part. But in particular to what Allie just mentioned, a while back, Yelp partnered with Code for America and the City of San Francisco on a program called the Local Inspector Value Entry Specification. And so what it is, it's basically, it's an open data standard that started off, well, with the city of San Francisco, and it's branched out to other cities, including Boulder, Colorado, Louisville, Kentucky, Seattle, Washington, Los Angeles, and more to come. But it's an open data standard that allows health inspectors to take their data that they've accumulated from inspecting various restaurants and other facilities within their area and export it to Yelp directly, where we take it and are then able to display it on the individual pages for those businesses. So you can find out if that Chinese food restaurant in San Francisco, you know, doesn't have, while it might have 4 stars, does it actually have a health score that's a 90 or 30? And that's information that's, it's publicly available information, but that we decided to enter into this partnership and to create this open data specification because we felt that with our platform, it gets more eyeballs on it. And that's really something that the city of San Francisco thought about as well. They're a government agency that's accumulating a lot of data, but what's the point of having data like that if you're not actually making the consumers and customers aware of it? And so Yelp is a platform that gets a lot more eyeballs than most government page sites in general. And so having it displayed there, it actually provides an additional benefit to the consumer. And another thing that we did that was actually similar to this, we partnered a while back with the City of New York's Health Department. And we took 100,000 or so reviews for restaurants in the city from 2013 and gave them to the Health Department. And the Health Department basically used kind of like a keyword finder, searched through all of these reviews to see if particular words popped up. You know, dirty, filthy, mouse, rat, roach, something along those lines for restaurants. And it turned out that, well, for six restaurants, it actually popped up quite a lot. A lot, so much so that they then decided to actually go and visit those restaurants and inspect them. And it turned out that they ended up shutting down 3 of them for health code violations. Now, would they have found those places otherwise without that information from the Yelp reviews? Perhaps. However, were they able to better direct limited resources in a more efficient manner to actually find and target restaurants that more likely than not had health code violations? Yes, they were. And another thing that we've then been experimenting since then with the city of Boston is actually saying, okay, if the Yelp reviews themselves seem to contain information that correlates to a certain degree with what health inspectors might find, is there a way to even sort of look at it from a more proactive or predictive standpoint? And so we've been working with the city of Boston as well to develop a model that they can actually use by looking at Yelp reviews. And as you and anyone else writes a review, and if you mention some keywords or points, they can then say, oh, well, maybe we should go and look at that place as well because the Yelp data that's continuing to come in is saying that it might contain a risk or some kind of a violation there. And so what's interesting is that you have this process where you have a private company like Yelp that's using public data and basically giving it a much bigger sort of stage to be seen upon. But then at the same time, we're also realizing that as Yelp, as we're accumulating a tremendous amount of data on our own in the form of reviews, which unto themselves and to a certain extent are public, because you can see all of the reviews that are up there, but is there a way that we can also work with governmental agencies in order to kind of provide a public service in that way, especially when it comes to food safety?
How do you protect against a concerted campaign? As we know, on Yelp, there are a lot of people with very strong opinions. They'll give you 1 star if there's a long line. But how do you protect against a concerted campaign to harass a restaurant owner for whatever reason that has nothing to do with, like now I could very well see somebody watching this at home, sitting on Reddit, saying, here's how we shut down these restaurants that we don't like.
Sure, and thankfully you're not the first person to have asked a question in regards to people, you know, attempting to go onto platforms like Yelp and others in order to intentionally subvert or impact a business's reputation. But for Yelp in particular, we have what we describe as our recommended review software. So basically, we have a lot of automated systems and processes in place for people that are basically trying to either game the system from writing too many reviews for the same place from their own address. We also allow reviews to be basically flagged if they're believed to be in violation. And then beyond that, though, because we've seen it more often recently where people have actually taken to Yelp for protest purposes, whether it's, you know, a pizza place in Indianapolis that says that there, or excuse me, in Indiana that opposes gay marriage, or the lion, or the doctor who killed, or excuse me, the dentist who killed a lion not too long ago, Cecil the Lion. And so we also have a very substantial user operations team that goes and looks at basically reviews where there appears to be some sort of either fraudulent effort at play or that are protest reviews in violation of our terms of service. Because for Yelp, the main thing with our terms of service is that it has to be an honest firsthand experience. And we do everything that we can in order to ensure that the reviews up there meet that. That's why we really think that our data is seen as being generally more trusted. Our reviews are more trusted than other platforms. The fact of the matter is that it's very difficult to achieve anywhere near 100% degree of certainty when it comes to online reviews. But we, in general, take a lot more strides, I would say, to ensure that there's a higher degree of credibility there, which is,
so
in part, I think.
So if you are partnering with a public institution, is Yelp prepared to make your algorithms, your other methods for ensuring that your data has integrity, are you willing to make that public? I think that's an important thing to think about. I mean, we were just talking about proprietary software that Target and Walmart maintain to collect data, but they aren't partnering with public institutions to grade and rate other private institutions. So I just want to put that question out to Yelp. Mm-hmm. Are you guys willing to be transparent in not only how you assess a recommendation, but also your other business practices in terms of selling advertising to one restaurant and not to another?
Well, I think that we should make a little bit of a distinction between parts of your question. So in regards to the LIVES program, the Local Inspector Value Entry Specification, which is what allows health departments to export their information to Yelp, that's an open data standard. You can go onto GitHub right now, see the code on there, and if you're a local health department in a city wherever, you can decide to enter into a program, have it there, and do that. The reviews and sort of the overall ratings on Yelp and the recommendation software in particular are things that are generally we consider proprietary. And part of the danger is if we made our algorithms and everything on that in public, you're basically telling people how to game a system. And so that would in essence make the whole process, those reviews that are then there, less trustworthy if all of a sudden if you're the type of person who actually wants that, you know, unfairly influence your reputation online and you know how to do it, you'll probably go down that road then. But at the same time, the reviews are still up there in the sense that even reviews that aren't recommended are still on the not recommended page, so you can still find them there. And then we still try to work with business owners in order to give them the opportunities to respond to reviewers directly. And in regards to advertising, you know, no one at all has to buy advertising on Yelp. And I thankfully know a lot of business owners and restaurateurs who have very good ratings on Yelp who, you know, they say, I don't know how I got this. You know, I have a great Yelp rating, but I didn't even know what Yelp was until people just started coming in here based off of it. And so it's one of those things where I think that in general, as online reviews continue to become this bigger, you know, sort of influence in how people make purchasing decisions, that there's still an adjustment window that's happening with a lot of businesses.
Right. I guess my point was more about the fairness. I feel like we're talking about fairness for individuals, about their buying decisions. And I think it cuts both ways, that it's fairness for the business owner as well. And we appreciate the opportunity to be able to respond. But I don't know, I just am uncomfortable with the idea of a private institution deciding what comments are relevant and not, and then winnowing or taking that data and sending it over to the health department. So I think that's why it needs to be open and transparent about how exactly that works.
Well, on that end, that's something that we've still sort of done in a one-off, in a sense. You know, there's a blog post about it that we posted back in July in regards to this with the city of Boston, and really working with them there to see just to the extent that they want to go along with actually utilizing the data. But the reviews are there, and you know, there are over 83 million reviews on Yelp. And in a lot of ways, if they can be utilized to actually provide better information to government agencies in order to make more informed decisions, I think that that's a very powerful thing, because these are people that are local in the community who have shared their firsthand honest experience of it. And honestly, it's something that is a tool that allows to get hyper granular, while at the same time still avoiding actually the issues of privacy and the issues of actually data mining individuals who don't know that they're being data mined. Because people who go on the platform in the first place are going on there to actually share their opinion about a business. And that's something that I think that is actually better in certain ways, because at least the consumer and the individual is aware of what's being done with it.
Actually, it would be great if we could just take a step back. And Laura, I'd really like to hear a little bit about some of the stuff, about some of the way the Restaurant Association is sort of using, or the restaurant industry is using data to change the hospitality industry generally, and sort of the lessons that can be learned from restaurants. Sort of back to the topics more at the USDA, and Virginia and Pam were talking about what kind of food is being eaten and sort of what the needs are of people and preferences are of people. So what sort of technologies are sort of playing a role in that process for restaurants?
Sure. So where to begin? So restaurants are getting on the big data bandwagon. Restaurants, I've been at the Restaurant Association for just over a year now, and I think I've learned, and it's a lesson that we think about every single day, is how small profit margins are in the restaurant industry. And so any opportunity that we get to streamline our operation, make things more cost effective, we are all in. But the great side benefit, or maybe even the major benefit of data collection, is that it helps us to do our jobs better, to be better hosts. Our goal in life is to serve our guests, prepare delicious food that they like and want to return to. So data collection about what people are eating when they're coming in, what are their general preferences, help us do our jobs better and make restaurants successful, given that any variety of factors could put us out of business, a bad Yelp review being one of them, that is so key to, you know, keeping the restaurant industry alive. Restaurants, you know, there's tons of restaurants out there. There are nearly a million here in the United States. And how do you compete? And that's based on, you know, doing that job better. So different restaurants are using different tools to collect information. I did want to note that restaurants are very different than a Target or Walmart or a big box retailer, or any type of retailer, because unlike those stores, a traditional retailer, we do not have UPC codes on our food. So it's really hard to standardize like who's eating what when across a variety of different restaurants. You can buy a huge order of chicken and use it in a variety of different dishes. It's hard to trace that all the way back to the individual. And then I also wanted to point out that we were talking about point of sale, and point of sale is a really big point of data collection for our restaurants. But it's also, there's other ways to collect data about people who are interacting in a restaurant who aren't actually paying anything. Point of sale is just one interaction. So I know that there are, not necessarily in a restaurant environment, but in retail environments, you know, using facial recognition, trying to get demographic information about, you know, a general, like, do we have men or women who come into our establishment? Are they young or old, or you know, do they come in with their family? So there's lots of other ways to collect information other than point of sale, and I just wanted to highlight that fact.
Yeah, that's really interesting. Actually, one of my closest friends is a high-end server in Chicago, and she told this really interesting story about a customer who came in and had a pretty normal meal as far as she was concerned, and then later called the restaurant to complain and to try and get a discount. And they actually were able to look her up, I think. Well, she had made a reservation through a system, and they were able to look up, and other restaurants had left notes on her profile saying that she does this a lot, and comes and has a meal and enjoys it, and then calls and complains and tries to get a discount, which seems like a completely fair use of tracking somebody. But you can see that same technology sort of to that you could use to make to raise a red flag like that, which is pretty within the bounds, being used to make some out of bounds assessments as well about a person's behavior. Right, in a restaurant.
Right, so I think restaurants use data in two different ways. One, about general trends about their restaurant. Who, you know, when are people coming in? What are they generally eating? And what is their average check size in order to streamline their operations? Then you have the more granular data collection about individual patrons. I mean, what we at the National Restaurant Association advise our restaurants is to give your patrons, your customers, real choice about what is being collected. That's really important. And only keep the data that you absolutely need to have. Any data that you do have is a liability. You know, there's lots of focus on data breach, and restaurants and other retailers often get stung by data breach because it's the release of the payment card information. But as we've been seeing recently, hackers seem to be coming for embarrassing details. Other information, and so wouldn't it be terrible for a restaurant to collect this information that I really like, you know, venti iced coffees at Starbucks at this certain time, and I'm always buying two of them, you know, so would that be embarrassing to me? I certainly wouldn't, you know, patronize Starbucks if they, you know, divulge that granular information, if they were collecting that information about me. So this is a long way to say that we advise our restaurants to be mindful of the creepiness factor, because again, it's you don't want to cross that line. You want to be a great host, but you don't want to indicate that you know too much about the person. And so there are definitely, you know, technology platforms out there. This is a huge and growing field, technology and restaurants. There are endless amounts of panel discussions and conferences about this because it's a real area for growth. But always, you have to be mindful of what your customers' preferences are, and that's, you know, the hospitality for the digital age.
I'm curious if Virginia has anything to add on this sort of general question.
Yeah, so I was thinking about sort of the challenges of algorithmic decision making, and I think there's some real possible benefits of being able to scale up our ability to integrate lots of different information about people's practices, and to use that to make more well-informed, more correct decisions about how people behave. But I think there's two really big challenges around algorithmic decision making, that whether that's policy or just individual decision making, that we have not figured out the answers to yet in this fairly new area. One of them is what I like to think of as sort of structural garbage in, garbage out. And we've been talking a lot about data at like the big faceless massive data set level and at the individual level, and then your issues are about privacy. This kind of data collection, sharing, storage, and decision making does carry and even can amplify assumptions that we make about groups of people, right? So for example, the example I always use is around predictive policing. And predictive policing in, particularly in Los Angeles, the very, very early versions of the databases that predictive policing are built on in Los Angeles actually came out of the Rampart Division. I don't know if anybody knows what the Rampart Division was. So the Rampart Division is a notoriously corrupt and racist division of the LAPD that was shut down, and all of its members were fired about 15 years ago. It was a really, really big, very high-profile problem. I mean, the police officers were selling drugs and shaking people down and murdered some people. It was really a huge mess. But what they also did was collect a lot of data on people who they identified as gang members. And that data is still in the LAPD system, right? So all of these collectors of the data who had assumptions about how people behave, what they do, what criminals look like, where criminals live, were recognized as being inappropriate collectors of data and were taken out of the system, but the data itself remains there, right? So listening to Laurent talk, one of the things that came to mind for me is if there are social assumptions about groups of people who are dirtier than other groups of people, then that might be something that shows up in the reviews, which isn't connected at all to the actual, you know, environment or the evidence on the ground, right? So, for example, Airbnb folks, people of color who have Airbnb apartments have to charge like 30% less than white people, because people assume that their neighborhoods are more dangerous, that they're not comfortable, the mostly sort of white customers of Airbnb, and so there are these structural producers of garbage data that come along with living in a society where we make assumptions about people based on demographic information, right? So it's really worth thinking about that in-between level between like this big faceless data set and these individuals, but there are group dynamics that get fed into these systems. And the second thing Laurent already brought up, which is the possibility of gaming systems. Like even if you don't release that algorithm, people will game it, right? Like, because that algorithmic decision making just begs for system gaming. And I've never seen a decision making based on a number score that has not been gamed. People will figure it out. I think that's a big question to think about, right? So again, Laurent, your example made me think of how easy it would be to just put in reviews that say roach, 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 right? Until an inspector gets sent out. And now you don't have to worry about that if you don't actually have roaches in your restaurant, right? But it is, algorithms open up that possibility to find the vulnerabilities in the algorithm and then use that to, for maybe less than noble.
I will say that generally speaking, at least on Yelp as a platform, that there are a number of algorithms in play that go after that. Basically, while generally most of our information and our data focuses on individual businesses and knowing, you know, how often people in general frequent a business, we do also look at the sort of trustability of the person who's writing the review. So if you're writing 20 different reviews about other restaurants, or we can even move it beyond restaurants or whatnot, about any particular business that's basically saying particularly negative things, but generally speaking, it looks like you aren't even in the same city, perhaps. Maybe you're based, you know, you're doing this from Indonesia or somewhere, and it's, you know, eventually the software will pick up on that, or it'll pick up on other things as well. So again, while you can't have perfect algorithms necessarily, you can at least create enough barriers so that it makes it incredibly difficult for people to game the system at scale. And that's really, I think, one of the things that you have to factor. There's always going to be a margin of error, but if you can make it small enough because it's so difficult to actually get those, you know, to game the system in such a manner, then it's still, and that's what I would argue is the case for Yelp reviews in general, leads to a lot of credibility in the information that's contained within them.
Sorry, go ahead.
Oh, I have something to say that has nothing to do with any of this. I want to take it back to food and what people eat. And I thought, Virginia, you had made a really interesting point that I would like for people to understand. When the arguments come up about whether or not you reveal what people who are using Snap are eating, you have this really strange group of bedfellows. You have people like Virginia who are all about, you know, liberty and privacy, and then you have like Coke and Pepsi who are all about their bottom line. And it's an odd and almost unbreakable alliance on that part. I waver on the idea of whether or not we should be looking at what people are eating and causing this information to be public so that it could be used for some public policy purpose, how to encourage people to eat more healthily. The one reason why I have always settled on your side of the issue is that if you release all of this data and show what people are eating and it turns out that everybody's having soda and chips, and then Congress acts to limit what people can eat, you have a whole lot of people who we serve who have no access to any other food. They would have zero calories because that is the only food that is available in their neighborhoods. What I would like to see is that this country completely turn around its whole food system so that this place is awash in healthy food, and then you can start looking at that. And then there's something that gets my feminist hackles up, and it's this. Oh no, Coke and Pepsi and all the big snack companies. Sorry, Coke and Pepsi, please. Give us donations. sorry, Daniel. They're not willing to share what people eat or to dictate what people eat, except for in the WIC program. Let's tell the moms what to feed their children, because they're the ones that, you know, really need the help and understanding that kids should have fruits and vegetables and healthy meats and eggs. That is the only nutritional program that is limited by the government. There's a list of things that you can buy if you're a woman receiving WIC, because the government seems to have no trouble telling women what to do. But everybody else, no, that's sacrosanct and sacred. So that annoys me. The thing that I love about the programs that we work with PPP, it is a very specific, it is for fruits and vegetables, or the SNAP. There's a national incentive matching program. USDA has put $100 million into this over 5 years, so $20 million matching SNAP benefits at farmers markets, and that tends to be only for fruits and vegetables. That's a carrot and a stick difference, right? The carrot, you're incentivizing people to eat something healthy as opposed to punishing them or preventing them from eating something that you don't want. And I've always been very impressed with the impact that that has. There's an inherent reward for our customers when they're making healthy choices. They can only make healthy choices with us. That's all that we sell. And that's one of the reasons why I'm not concerned about our data, because you cannot stigmatize our customers because they're all eating apples and kale. That is what we sell. And what I want our data to be able to do is to show people what is that relationship between apples and kale, and how do we boost the kale to apples or to peaches? And if we're doing a veggie prescription program, how do we tell? We can't tell right now, but we can with our system, if the vegetable that you're promoting that week with, you know, sauteed zucchini, if it actually results in more sales of zucchini, or are the moms still going back and buying fruit? So being able to tweak how we promote healthy food to all of our benefit, pay the farmer or pay the doctor.
I'm curious if anybody in our audience has any questions or has any sort of insights they want to add to this conversation so far. Yeah, Eric.
So I actually spent some time working on child nutrition reauthorization a while ago, and you can see at times the anti-hunger community and the nutrition community don't necessarily come down in the same place, and these are really hard questions, and they don't have a clear answer. But one thing that I'm wondering is it objectionable? I mean, definitely publicizing the use of SNAP benefits is beyond the pale. But if we know things like the SNAP cards are being used at convenience stores or in strip clubs, this could be an indication that either there's insufficient nutrition education, that there's someone living in a food desert, that we maybe need to make more of an investment in that particular school lunch program, because that school lunch program is going to be basically doing all of the work of making sure that kids get nutritious foods as opposed to what's for sale in the convenience store or the strip club. So are those kind of uses of data coming out of publicly supported nutrition programs objectionable?
So let me just clarify, you can't use SNAP benefits in a strip club. So there are limitations on what you can buy with SNAP, and you can't buy hot food, and you can't buy diapers or soap, right? But this is actually one of the things that's complicated and actually leads to misperceptions by people who aren't on public assistance. So for example, when you drive past the fried chicken place that says we take EBT, that doesn't mean that your people are using SNAP benefits to buy fast food, right? That means they take electronic benefit transfer cards, which may contain many different kinds of benefits, right? Including cash benefits. And it actually is a sneaky way to get people who are on public benefits, who think they might be able to buy fast food with SNAP benefits, into the store, right? And then you go up and you try to use your EBT card, and if you don't have cash benefits, you can't pay for your food, right? So just to clarify that, there are limitations about what you can use those benefits for.
Let me just briefly clarify.
Please.
You can buy hot prepared foods if you're of a certain
class. So if you are if you have a disability or if you're above a certain age, you can buy hot prepared foods. And so that's why you'll see, like, if you're at the 7-Eleven and people are buying hot wings, I don't think that the stores necessarily enforce it. They're not checking to see whether you're one of those. And then there's a place that I walked into in DC where you're not supposed to be able to buy prepared foods, and you sort of point out the fish in the window that you want, and then they prepare it for you and you pay with your EBT card. So there's ways around it. I don't think that it's prevalent, but I just want to make it clear that's not completely accurate.
And again, there are ways to game the system. Yeah. Like, yeah, in any kind of algorithmic, once you put them on EBT, like, it just shifts the kind of game, mm-hmm, that people play, away from selling coupons to negotiating,
could
getting
you explain
what you want
where the
otherwise
cash comes from on the EBT card?
It depends on the program, right? So part of TANF, the Temporary Aid to Needy Families, can come with a very small cash benefit, but it's really rare that people get it. It's a super small amount of money. It's like $12 a month for a family of six. You know, it's a very small amount of money. But to your larger question, you know, I think where it's interesting to be very gently called a libertarian by Pam, because I don't see myself as that at all. But it's also interesting because I think of the strange bedfellows issues around data and nutrition as being hearing really people who I think of as really progressive then counsel that we should make decision making impossible for people on public benefits. And I'm like, wait, how did you fall off the wagon of like thinking about self-determination here? So I just see it from a slightly different angle. Right, of course, I think we should have evidence-based policy making. Like, I think that's incredibly important. But I also think we should understand the context in which this data is collected, and I think more importantly, publicized, right? That we have a terrible track record on collecting data about poor and working people that starts, you know, is most obvious around something like the eugenics program, which was the big data program of the 1910s, right, and resulted in the compulsory sterilization of 60,000 poor and working, mostly women, in the United States and fed into the Nazi atrocities of World War II. So I think there's context here that we have to understand, that data doesn't then just sort of land on a totally blank slate of, oh, we now have information, we'll so obviously make better decisions, right? There's so many political decisions where we have perfectly good information and we make terrible decisions based on assumptions and stigma and injustices that exist in our society. So I think part of what the horse that I beat is, right, data means different things for different people, and that medium level, that social group level, is really important to understanding and predicting how that data might be used and interpreted.
Actually, I have another question, sorry, on the same sort of general topic, but one of the things that I've talked about with people at the USDA is that you could use SNAP and EBT cards, as far as I understand, the actual technology to facilitate people getting food that is, like, food that is otherwise not going to go anywhere better, right? So if you have a bunch of meat, which is more expensive, and I think there are restrictions, I'm not exactly sure, it's just harder to buy if you don't have as much money, sure, okay, that seems plausible. And it's got, you know, 2 days or 3 days left on its market value, the grocery store might already pull it from the shelf, but you could say, you know, if you have a SNAP card, you can come in and it will automatically give you double benefit the same way we would at a farmer's market for this, but you have to administer it through the actual technology of the card. But then, of course, it makes the card more vulnerable to this enforcement question, which I hadn't thought about, right? So then you have this ability to say, oh, we actually know you're over 70, your SNAP card is restricted away from buying these things. So it's curious to me, this hasn't already happened. I guess maybe Mojd, I don't know if you know anything about sort of the technology itself or the, you know, how it's controlled, but I'm curious what you guys would think about sort of the dual pieces of that question.
I think that's an interesting point. I don't know much about the technology, unfortunately.
Do we lose our microphone?
He popped up from the back.
Hi, John Breo with the National Consumers League. Thank you for this amazing discussion. One thing I haven't heard come up is the issue of security. With all the data that's flowing around the EBT system or the PPP system or the data that restaurants are collecting, I'm just wondering where in your decision making about all the data that you're collecting and how you're using that data, does the security of that data come into play? Particularly with regards to the restaurant industry, I mean, there's Dairy Queen and there's, you know, the Hilton restaurants have just been announced, they've been hacked. Are you thinking about that? Does you know, how does that affect what you're doing? I mean, in particular, I can think of, you know, sensitivity of data. You know, what I put in my mouth is probably very important and sensitive data to a lot of people. Do you think about security in that sense too, beyond just sort of like, can hackers get it? What are the people who are we're collecting data about? What do they think about the sensitivity of the data that you're collecting?
Well, I think I did talk a little bit about the security concerns that, you know, what the restaurant has is its reputation and its relationship with its guests. So, as part of being a good host, is also extending security to the data that they collect. So, we encourage our members to be mindful of security, you know, concerns. A lot of our members use third parties to collect this data, and the third party then prepares it. So not only internal security, which we must have, all restaurants who accept credit card and debit cards are bound by a certain set of network rules about protecting that particular data, but we are encouraging our restaurants to take enterprise-wide security seriously, and also have third-party vetting systems in place to make sure that the people who are collecting the data in terms of a loyalty program, that they too have a robust security program, because like, as I said at the beginning, that our reputation is pretty much, you know, one of the only things. We don't want to be the restaurant who is quick and easy and loses people's sensitive information. I guess, though, I do have a question about whether or not what you eat can be considered a sensitive. I don't think we've seen any piece of legislation that says we'll put that in the sensitive bucket. But who's to say? I think we might have a point of view on that. But, you know, especially if it's something that gets consumed in public. We don't need to debate that now. But, that's sort of the state of our thinking on the security aspect.
I do think there's some sensitivity about what you eat in terms of the inferences you can make about people's heritage and their cultural traditions and culinary traditions, right? So just at a sort of high level of what's actually considered sensitive information, you could infer some of the more defined pieces of sensitive information from people's culinary habits,
right,
at least
well,
in a rough sense.
I operate on a harm-based, thinking about data. So what would be the harm in someone knowing that you eat, you know, Chinese food or Indian food or what have you. So, I mean, I don't think this is something that's being actively debated, and we definitely have to take a closer look at it. But again, I apply the what's the harm, and if there is a harm, how can we protect against that harm?
Chris Beck from USDA. This is a great conversation. And this question really doesn't have anything to do with the hat I wear in the government, but it seems like these are really complicated issues, and I find myself going back to some slightly different, not food-related, but water-related. One of the things that USDA is trying to do is help get broadband to Central Valley in California so that large users of water can measure the through the wireless system the moisture in the soil to save water, which is a huge public interest. So the farmer would have the data, but there's probably good reasons that the public should have that data as for who's a pig. In fact, now that I say that, my hometown newspaper in Portland does a annual water hog story where they brandish the 10 people who use waste the most urban water on their yards. It's kind of funny. I think that there are public purposes for knowing that the public should know about certain things and the way people are using resources, or maybe even using our public tax dollars to purchase healthy food or unhealthy food. This is a continuum, right? And I unfortunately missed some of the conversation, but I'm wondering if any of you have sort of general guidance for how you or how we as a society should evaluate this discussion on that continuum. because everyone's going to come out a little differently, right? There are going to be some people who say, no information about anything should be available to anybody, and some people are ultimate transparency. I want to know every political contribution that every person has made to every politician, because that's in the public interest to know where all the money's going and to whom and when and why. So let's probably agree that there is some relativity of view on this, and there's probably a range of where we can agree to disagree but not get too hot about it. How do we get to that point of, or what are the principles that we as a society can be deploying to reach a sensible and not necessarily middle ground, but just a piece of ground on information, whether it's related to food or more general? That's a complicated question.
That's a good one. I want to go last on that one. I want to hear what other people have to say.
Or too big a question to even try to answer, probably.
I'll just sort of say from my perspective and sort of the case with Yelp, at least all of the information that's available there has been provided with the consent of the user. And so that's kind of the easiest, if you're gonna start from a particular area of like, how do you acquire data that could potentially be turned over to the public or for a public good, it's just with their actual consent and with their permission. They wrote it on a public platform in the first place, or I should say a platform that's public facing. And so there's a general assumption from the writer at that point that it will be available more or less as a public good or for others to see. And so if you have other platforms that are generally speaking out there that either allow for people to give their consent as to how their data should be used, or just that it will be used as a part of a sort of a collective purpose, that's kind of the easiest way, I think, just right out of the gate. Just let people know.
I think a lot of what Laura said earlier too when she was explaining how she advises restaurants was relevant. Data minimization, don't retain things you don't need, just in case you might need it later.
I also think one thing that's really important about data is contextualization and making sure that you have a context and you're not looking at it in a vacuum. Because what's powerful about data, I think it's probably what we have been talking about as dangers of data today, which is the whole idea that you can slice and dice it any which way. And unless you have a context that's appropriate to the data, I think, as we've heard a lot of examples, things can go horribly awry. So long as the context is appropriate and explained, I think we can be along the continuum and we can reach middle ground.
So two things. One quick, and I'm picking on you, Laurent. I'm sorry.
It's okay. I have a thick skin.
But I think that inform and consent, which often people talk about as a baseline for thinking about ethical behavior around data, is challenging, particularly when you're thinking in the context of public programs, because meaningful consent means that you have an opportunity to make other decisions. And so if you're like in Rensselaer County where I live, the application for public benefits is like 65 pages long. On page 34, there's a line that basically says, we can share your information with anyone we want for any reason, right? And you're like, yes. Because otherwise you can't even talk to a caseworker, right? It's not like you won't get benefits. You can't even talk to a caseworker if you don't give them your social security number. So you can't even ask where there's a food pantry if you're not like here, like you can share this with anyone you want. So I think that stretches the boundaries of consent. And so that's why I'm a little suspicious of informing consent as a like meaningful way to think about the ethics of data, particularly in public programs. And now I'm gonna say something, can't think of the word, it'll come to me, that might rile people up, which is I believe that the amount of visibility around your behaviors, your habits, your movements through public space should be inversely related to the amount of power you have. So the more powerful you are, the more transparent your life should be to the rest of us. The less power you have, like the more invisible your life should be. And I think that's currently the absolute opposite of how the system works now, which is the lives of poor and working people are hyper visible. Every decision they make, every choice they make, every habit they have is very, very, very visible to lots of people outside of their immediate context. And it has real material impacts on their lives. It gets their kids taken away from them. It gets their benefits suspended, it gets them sanctioned, it gets them sent to jail. And so I think if we can do something to flip that script a little bit, I'd be really happy to see that.
Provocative
is the word I was looking for. Thank you, Chris.
I think we've had our panelists sitting under the lights for a really long time. But Aaron wants to ask a question, so I guess we'll let him ask one more. He's looking sad. No, it's okay. We already have them here.
The great big question you asked, which it seems to me we have two ends of the spectrum here when it comes to the consumer and kind of privacy issue. On one end, I'm not sure any of us love the idea of people being publicly shamed by name online with your address to withdraw from benefits. On the other hand, it doesn't bother me at all that Pamela is trying to decide whether kale or apples are more successful in a given way. I think the really hard situation comes in, and I'm glad you said the ethics of data, is imagine a world in which Walmart led a giant coalition of major grocery stores. And came to us and said, you know, we realize that food is important and we want to help solve this problem and we want to feed people more nutritiously and help people on public benefit programs eat better. So we want to release our data set in some way, shape, or form. Now, tell us how granular we should be on like a neighborhood level. Tell us whether we should differentiate between public benefits and non-public benefit shoppers, and tell us what the right answer is there. And I just think that, you know, this is more of a monologue than a question, but I think it's really interesting to wonder at what point does like the privacy concern give way to kind of the bare political prediction of what's going to happen with this data in the political environment. And so what I'll come up to, I'm just curious as to what you, like Virginia's answer would be to that and to Pam's answer would be to that, because those are really hard questions because you're essentially guessing. Is this going to help people more than it hurts people? Once you take the possibility of Allie's eating habits being re-identified out of the equation. So
there's a really interesting piece of what you said, and that is, should we differentiate between whether they're using public benefits or their own money? And I think from my perspective, I would like to see that as one group because we are all part of one food system and our whole nation has a sick food culture. And if we want low-income people to change how they eat, we have to change the entire food culture, and that means talking to people who have more money and can make their own choices. But that then gives me a conundrum, which is, so how do I tell what interventions the people who have low income need and what will help them make better decisions? The answer might be it's the same interventions that people who have money need, but you do have to slice that somehow to see what the difference is. So I think that you could assume, and I think I did assume when PPP came out, the $10 free fruits and vegetables, that we would see it as an additive benefit and people would just be like, sweet, more fresh fruits and vegetables. But instead it's in many cases, it's a substitute benefit where they're then switching how much they then spend on out of their own pocket on fruits and vegetables and are now spending it on something else. So we're learning something very important about people's food budgets and the choices that they're making that we wouldn't be able to do if we didn't slice that data. So it's a really tough question, and I think you've kind of honed in on the central piece of it. I have no answer. You.
No, I think that's a great answer. I want Pam to have the last word on this question, except for if you've got the phone number of that guy at Walmart, I'd love to have that conversation with him. I'll give you my card.
Awesome. This was great. Thanks, panelists. That was really fun.
Thank you.
Thank you.